Christmas season. There's a lot that goes on that we remember at Christmas. Surely one of the greatest wonders is how does God become man? And I don't know if we've got a how, but we surely do have a yes, it did, in John chapter 1. So if you'll join in reading from that passage with me as we remind ourselves about the incarnation of the Word of God. Scripture starts, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Will you join me? "He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known." It's a passage that's full of joy and also some notes of sadness. The sadness, he came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But joy, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Truly, for those of us who have believed, who have received him, it is a joy. And let's celebrate that this morning, beginning as we sing "Joy to the World." Thank you. And read. Christmas is a time when all sorts of amazing switches or changes or exchanges are celebrated and can be remembered. The Creator becomes a creature. The infinite becomes an infant. The sinless, he who knew no sin, became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The rich, because of his grace, becomes poor for our sake, that we might become rich in him. This song celebrates some of those exchanges. You may or may not know it. If you know it, please sing along. By the time we get to the third verse, I hope you will know it. And we'll sing the third verse together a couple of times as an act of praise, not just of telling the truth, but of singing to the one who himself is the way, the truth, and the life, and who came to make it possible for us to go to the Father.
Thou who art love. You have your Bibles with you this morning. I don't know that you'll need to open them, but John 3:16 is our verse for the day. And you can hopefully recite it by memory, or once you get there, if you wouldn't mind, we're going to stand in reverence for the reading of God's Word. We'll begin. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. Father, we come before you this morning, and Lord, we thank you for once again this time we can come into your house. And Father, just fellowship and being together, Father, in this time where the world seemed a little crazy. And Father, just focus on you. Father, you are the answer for everything. And so, Father, we look to Jesus this morning. He is our hope. He is our rock. He is our refuge, Father, where we go to lean in on and, Father, just to get some peace in this world. Father, it's all because of him. And Father, I don't know how everybody else feels in their heart, Father, but if there's somebody here that doesn't know that doesn't know this hope that they have or can have in Jesus Christ, Father, I pray today will be the day of salvation for them. And Lord, we just come and we lean upon the cross and we lean upon this manger, Father, that we celebrate this time of year. And we give you all praise and all glory and all honor. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The greatest gift that the world has ever had or ever will have happened when God so loved the world. Beloved, at Christmas, the love that God has shown us came to us in giving us his Son, Jesus Christ. It's right here in the gospel message. God is screaming that he loves us right here. He released his love through this gift when he took on human flesh and became this child in the manger that we focus on this time of year. And it's from this point on that he now begs the question, will you believe? Will you follow him by faith through his Christ? John explains it so well that the spirit of God's love supersedes all other things, as Nicodemus asks the question, how can one be born again? And Jesus begins to tell him the plan of salvation for all mankind. The entirety of the gospel message comes into focus in these few verses right here that we're looking at here at Christmas time. Thank God for his gift. Thank God for his story of love as we read, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. There's no need for me to add anything extra to this morning. It's not a complicated passage. God's love came. It's a simple message of truth. And it came to any and all who would believe that truth. It's a love that reaches down and draws you to himself. Salvation, beloved, comes as a free gift, but you have to believe it. You have to accept it as truth into your hearts and into your minds before it can take effect. Our text tells us that God's actions define the pattern of what true love is. For God so loved. We all know that it was God that initiated this action of giving the one and only begotten Son. We've studied it through the book of Ephesians. We don't search out for righteousness. In fact, most people feel as though they're already righteous up to themselves. That we don't need to be saved. But beloved, we do. We are not righteous in any sense of the word. We're hopelessly lost in sin outside of God's grace. And yet in our lostness, in our being away from God, God intervenes. He chose to move in being the one that came. See, God had this all worked out in his plan before creation ever came into existence. There would have been no hope, beloved. All of us would have been forsaken, doomed to an eternity in hell had God not came. But God, our Creator, is an active God. He's a living God. He's a loving God. And he's a God that involves himself in the workings of mankind by coming into the world. Our Lord Jesus here, in describing this to Nicodemus, describes something so incredible, beloved, in telling us about the actions of God the Father, that he uses the phrase one and only, which in the Greek is monogenes. Mono meaning only, and genos meaning of its kind. It's a truly remarkable statement. It's saying God himself came. The one and only God came. Jesus is God. He is of God. He is God. He's the one and only that could redeem us back to himself. The King James attaches begotten to it to emphasize that the Son is of the Father. But there is no one else like Jesus Christ. It is a sign here for us of his great love. With it, we can say it is the greatest love. It's the greatest gift. It's the greatest blessing that anyone could ever receive in receiving Jesus Christ. Notice in the passage, we get a glimpse of the birth and the ministry and the cross and his death, his resurrection. All of it is wrapped up in just a few verses here. It's the entire message of the Christ affirmed by one key word: belief. And that's where all of you come in. Do you believe that God so loved the world? And in believing that God so loved the world, do you believe that he would go to the extremes of giving his one and only begotten Son to save the world? You see, the whole story of reconciliation to God is found right here in God's love. And I hope that we can grasp the incredible mercy that is given by a God in sending his Son, Jesus, as a baby in a manger. That God would step into time and space. That he would leave the beauty of heaven. We just sang it in the song just a second ago. To come into a fractured creation that alienated itself from him. To give you and I a gift. A gift to choose how and where we will spend eternity. No matter what you choose. Whether you choose to be with him or whether you choose to be without, he gets all the glory. The book of Romans tells us pretty clearly, apart from God's grace, we are enemies of God. No one searches out for God. No one seeks his truth. But yet, while we were still sinners, God initiated this act, an act to redeem you from sin, from destruction, back to himself, so that we can give him praise. Christ Jesus came to die for you, so that he could, upon your belief in him as the one and only Son of God, redeem your life with his life. He came in the flesh to do that because he loved his creation. He loved each of you. And the remarkable thing is that he gives us some liberty then to love him back. You see, it's easy to love someone who reciprocates that feeling. But to love because we are loved. But God's love is a supernatural love, church. God's love is a greater love. That God even goes so far as to love the sinner. God loves those who rebel against him. He even loves the one who are disobedient to him. In spite of all that we did against him, in spite of our meanness and our blatant disobedient sinfulness, God shows us his great unconditional love because he is a great God. How precious is it then, beloved, to know that God's love for us is limitless. It's without merit. To describe this kind of love, the length that God has gone, John uses the word agape, which, as most of you know, is the highest form of love spoken of in the Greek language. It literally means love completely, love without condition. It's an enduring love. It's a love that never changes no matter our circumstances. because it comes from the greatest of gifts. It comes from the Father through the Son. Because of God's love, within the scope of who God is and what He is, in the love He has for us. Beloved, it is truly a tremendous statement that we were given the Son as a gift. You understand the limits that God has gone. What God is willing to do, if He is willing to send the Son as a gift of love for His creation. Again, the greatest gift that you or I could ever receive is the love from the Father through Jesus Christ, the one and only Son of God. And it's a gift that's available right now. This very moment that we're speaking of, the gift is available. See, God gave us the supreme gift of giving Himself in the person of Jesus Christ. He was there in the beginning as the agent of creation when the universe was formed. He was there that formed Adam from the dust of the ground and breathed life into him. He was there as He walked with Abraham and Isaac, and He wrestled with Jacob, and He stood there before Joshua with the sword drawn. He was the one that danced in the fires with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He was the one that hushed the mouth of lions as Daniel sat quietly in their den. It was a pre-incarnate Christ that stood in all of His full glory and splendor before the prophets Isaiah and Ezekiel. He was spoken of to every single generation. We find Him in the Gospels walking on the water and calming the storms and healing the sick and causing the blind to see. It was He that raised dead men to life. And just as God planned it, after He came as a baby, He later rose on the cross and from the grave. He did this, beloved, to sacrifice and pay for our sin debt. It's part of the picture that we see here that John is painting for us when he says, God so loved the world. Just before this, in verse 14, John takes us back to Numbers 21, and he points to the cross where Jesus, like the snake that Moses rose up in the desert, Jesus will be lifted up there. And then in verse 16, he takes us to Genesis chapter 22, where a son was given. You may remember that passage. It's when Abraham was taking his son that he loved, his son of the promise, from the mountain. And Isaac asked his father, Dad, we have all that we need. I think we've got the wood and we've got the knife, but I don't see a sacrifice. And God, and Abraham says, God will provide the sacrifice. Think about those words, beloved, as Jesus is talking to Nicodemus here. God will provide the sacrifice. And it's up on that mountain where Isaac is placed on the altar and Abraham draws out the knife to kill his son, his one and only son, his son of promise, the son that he dearly loved. And right at that time, God provides the sacrifice. He provides the lamb stuck in the thicket. And John says, light came into the world. He came into the very world that he created. He came into the world so that all who believe will be given the right to be called children of God. For this is the Lamb that God sent to take away the sins of the world. That's the kind of love that God has for us. You see, the essence of Christmas is this promise of love from the Father to save all of His children on the decision that you make on whether or not to believe in the one and only begotten Son. Personally, I was always taught, when you were given a gift, you receive it and you appreciate it. You were thankful. And we are thankful as thankfulness comes out in trusting God in the way that we live. We live a life that is pleasing. We live a life that is acceptable to Him. And we produce good fruit that will then bring praise to our Father in heaven. We trust and believe in Christ. And we live for Him. That's the greatest blessing. Because then He says, we will not perish, but we will have everlasting life. The word perish that Jesus uses here is the word ekthetos. which actually means to cast out from or to be offered from destruction. The implication is very clear. Those who refuse to believe are cast out from God. Verse 17 and 18, we didn't read those today, but see, God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn it, but to save it. But those who refuse to believe in God's Son, if you so choose to not believe and you reject Him, you're rejecting the greatest gift that God could ever send to you. You're rejecting God's love. And in essence, you're condemning yourself to an eternity away from God. See, beloved, God's purpose is never for anyone to perish. 2 Peter 3:9 tells us that it's not God's desire that anyone should perish, but rather we were created to worship and to praise Him, to bring Him glory. Notice in all this passage that Jesus is the central figure. He is the focus. That's where our attention is to be drawn. As Romans 11:36 tells us, for from Him and to Him and through Him are all things made. And thus we read that in verse 17. God's saving grace is done through Him. It's because of Jesus that we're forgiven. And salvation has been made possible to you who would believe. But again, you have to be willing to receive and accept that which is done for you. John talks about perishing. It's not to cease to exist. It's to experience complete loss and eternity without hope. What do we need more than anything this time of year? We need hope. We need Jesus. We need joy and light. Thus, those who are saved and those who are not saved, it's our choice. Whosoever believes, beloved, is a choice. It's a choice that we have to decide on what we're going to do with Jesus. From birth, we're in a state of condemnation. We're sinners. And what God has done is He provides a way for us to come to Him, to make us whole again. However, Jesus doesn't stop there. He tells us why we need a Savior. The passage goes on to say that men love darkness, that people actually reject Christ because of the evil that we have in our hearts. And we would rather stay in darkness and hide our sin than yield ourselves to Jesus Christ as Lord. But He's there. He is always there, and He represents God's glory. He represents God's goodness and purity and holiness. He is the light of God. We just sang about light coming into the world. His light exposes us to what is holy and righteousness. And it teaches us what needs to be removed from our life, all the darkness and all the sin that we like to hide in. You see, beloved, Jesus is the reason for the season. He is the one that has everything that we need to make us whole again. It's God's greatest gift, God's love to each of us. Again, the question is, will you believe?
What a wonderful message of love. To be rejoiced in, to be worshipped because of, and to be shared. Sing we the song of Emmanuel, God with us, foretold, come, and saving. Let's rejoice. Sing we the song of Emmanuel, this the Christ who was long foretold, low in the shadows of Bethlehem, promise of dawn now our eyes behold, God most high in a manger laid, lift your voices and now proclaim, great and glorious love has come to us, now with the host of heaven. wind and rain.